tonight a delightful program about the great jazz pianist George Shearing. George Shearing was born in 1919 into a large, impoverished family in London, and he was born blind. But he went on to become one of the most popular jazz musicians in the world, as well as a classical pianist and a player of great ballads. In the late 40s, he moved to America, where he's been based ever since. It was there he developed a new warm sound, a blend of vibraphone, piano and guitar, backed by bass and drums. He quickly formed the George Shearing Quintet and went on to compose 300 works, including his hit tune September in the Rain, which still sells strongly today. Along the way, he formed strong partnerships with many musicians, including Nat King Cole, Mel Torme and Peggy Lee. George Shearing is now 75 years old, and as you'll see, he's a really delightful man who wears his great talent very lightly.
The string men were sort of the legitimate section, and the jazz guys were the usual jazz guys. They, matter of fact, they had almost a rigid separation in lifestyles. We traveled in two different buses at times, and even in one bus, the strings were always in one part of the bus and the jazz band in another. Now and then there would be crossovers. It was like two enemy camps, two alien camps.
Our second feature film was a musical comedy.
Turned out to be a total hodgepodge. Anyway, that was, I got into that one. Again, playing myself.
Of course, Mr. Chisholm talks a lot, but he's sweet. He says he has the soul of an artist, but that his money's stifling it. Now, you've always wanted to give a concert. I know I can get him to back you.
How do I know he's any different from those crunchy, crinkled breakfast food guys? They've all got some angle.
All right, I'll guarantee to get him without one string attached.
No musts about what I should play?
None.
No bottle cap ads?
On a bright.
Okay, sounds swell if you can do it.
Good. I'll get to work on it right away.
Yeah? What? Him! Throw him out!
Because of the size of that orchestra and because of what we were trying to do musically and from the point of view of arranging, there wasn't a lot of room for freedom for the kind of improvisation you get with small groups. And as a result, I decided I would put together several small groups in that band. And instead of calling them trios, quintets, and septets, I used the New York Telephone Exchange. At that time, there was a Chelsea 3, and there was a Gramercy 5, and there was a Trafalgar 7. We had all of them, but we actually recorded with the Gramercy 5, and so that's the group that people mostly know. And the first recording we ever made was rehearsed in my house up on Summit Ridge Drive in above Beverly Hills. And when we got down there, recorded the thing, after it was recorded to our satisfaction, the control man, or the A&R man, the artist and repertoire man at that time, said, "What do you want to call it? What's the name of it?" And I said, "We don't have a name, but might as well call it Summit Ridge Drive." So that was it. Want to hear it?
Thank you.
please me. The audience, fine. If they liked it, that's great. If they didn't like it, I was in trouble because they wouldn't pay me and I couldn't hire the men I needed to play the music I wanted to play to please me. The vicious circle. I didn't want to give them only what they wanted. I also give them what I wanted to. Very important. You try to do what you have to do as a developing human being. At a certain point, the band had worked maybe 6 months to 8 months or a year. I figured that I needed to know more, and I broke up the band. I was studying music seriously. I also scored and wrote a script for the Pied Piper of Hamelin. And after I had done what I had to do and learned what I had to learn, I formed another band again with the strings. Same type of orchestration, only a different bunch of guys, because a lot of the guys who were in the original band had gone their way. Billy Butterfield wasn't there, and I got Hot Lips Page then. And there was a black guy in the middle of this band. One here, strange story about that. At one point, we were told, my agents told me that we were supposed to play down south, a big, very lucrative tour of the south. And I agreed to take it. I'd signed the contracts. And then my agent came back, very chagrined, and said, Artie, we got some problems. I said, what's that? He said, well, they don't want Lips Page in the band. I said, well, who the hell are they to tell me who I should have in my band? If they don't want the band, that's fine. Let them break the contracts. That's okay with me. So they said, no, we'll talk to them. So they went back, and it was a lucrative tour for me. It must have been for the agency as well. So they came back and said, they've got a solution. This is unbelievable, truly unbelievable, but it's dead true. They proposed that you could take Lips on the tour and he could sit in the band, but he had to sit no nearer than 15 feet from the nearest member of the band. I couldn't believe my ears. I said, you mean I'm going to have the band on a bandstand and Lips is going to be sitting out there by himself 15 feet away? Yeah. I said, well, you guys are kidding. You have to be kidding. Cancel the tour, and that was the end of the Southern tour. So that was it. But again, I wasn't fighting for Lips, I was fighting for sanity. Every once in a while, I would turn the theater into a concert stage. And I'd say, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to play a piece for you now that I think is a marvelous piece of music. I hope you'll bear with us. It's not what you usually hear. And we played Nocturne. And Nocturne is not your usual jazz band fare. It's jazz-oriented. It's jazz music. It's certainly not what you'd call symphonic European influence music. It's American music. But it was music rather than just jazz. It was music first, jazz second. And the audience would sit there, and at the end of it, a very quiet piece, it ended on a very quiet note. And there'd be a moment of silence, and then a huge burst of applause. So that was interesting to me. I mean, I was doing what I wanted to do. And audiences were paying for it, supporting it. So that's the best of all possible worlds. Yeah, I like that. If the war hadn't come along, I'd have probably stayed with that band quite a while. Anyway, after that, we played some more and ended up in Providence, Rhode Island. I was on stage and we had finished playing the first couple of pieces. And then I introduced, I think, a dance act that was part of the show. And I walked off into the wings to get a smoke. And I was standing in the wings and I heard a radio stagehand had turned on. And it said something about the Japs have bombed Pearl Harbor, and the announcer sounded absolutely hysterical. World War II has begun. And it was pretty scary. We knew that there was a lot of stuff going on. The Japanese ambassadors were in America at that point, or I think right then, talking to Roosevelt. And It was a pretty scary thing. Nobody quite knew. I certainly didn't know where Pearl Harbor was. I pictured some peaceful little atoll out in the Pacific. And about that time, a phone call came back to the stagehands. The manager had asked me to go out and make an announcement. The announcement was, all military personnel are to report to their bases immediately. This was in Providence, right near Newport, Rhode Island, where there was a submarine base, an air base, and a naval base. So I went out on stage at the end of the dance act and said, ladies and gentlemen, the management has asked me to make an announcement that all military personnel had to report to their bases immediately. And I guess 3/4 of the theater was emptied. I didn't realize how many men were in uniform. We took it for granted at that time. The war clouds were gathering. And I felt very strange when I saw that. A very strange sensation came over me. And on impulse, I announced the next tune. We'll now play our recording of Stardust, our recording version of Stardust. And I hit it for Billy Butterfield to start the solo, or whoever was playing first trumpet. I think it was Billy, but it could have been someone else. And then as he started playing, once they got into tempo, I walked over to front of the band and said to Les Robinson, lead alto man, pass the word around. This is 2 weeks' notice. I'm breaking it up. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm breaking up the band. And they all passed the word around. The rest of the show was a very somber one for us. And I went and joined the Navy. Just went downtown and enlisted. I don't know why, I can't tell you, but it seemed to me that what I was doing was so totally